This audiobook is distributed by Christian Audio. Please visit christianaudio.com to offer your impressions of this work and to explore additional titles.
Welcome to the Ministry of Living on the Edge with Chip Ingram. We trust that the upcoming message will inspire, encourage, and motivate you to apply what you learn as you live out your faith in Christ at home and at work each day. At the end of the message, you'll find information on how to contact Living on the Edge or obtain additional resources. Now, here's Chip.
When you talk about spiritual warfare and you think of the Christian community, you have the spectrum, don't you? I mean, that raises issues like, they're going to teach that here, you know? And over here you have people that, I mean, it is what they talk about all the time, and, you know, demonic spirits and territorial spirits, and there's all kind of things with the unseen world. And then you have whole branches of Christendom that would intellectually acknowledge that, yes, the Bible talks about Satan and demons, but, you know, that was probably at another time in another world, and I don't really see that stuff playing out in our day in this way. And sometimes, I don't know about you, but if you flick the little clicker on TV and you hear someone talking about spiritual battle, and, you know, I've heard literally some of the most wacko stuff I've ever heard in my life. Have you ever just thought to yourself, I wonder what the Bible actually teaches? And so what I want to tell you is we're going to do Spiritual Warfare 101, and that's session number one. And it's going to be the very basics. And then next session will be Spiritual Warfare 201. You know, this is just like a college, you know, class. And then we're going to go to Spiritual Warfare 301, and it's going to get a little bit more intense. And then we're going to get to graduate work, and we're going to do Spiritual Warfare 401. But here's the one promise I want to make. You know, I make no claim whatsoever to be an expert in this area. But what I want to tell you is this. There are extremes in the Christian community, but the Bible is very clear. There are certain things that we can come together and open the scriptures and we can know for 100% this is what God says about the area of spiritual warfare. Because we're not going to jump all over the world. You're going to open your Bibles to Ephesians chapter 6, and we're going to study for the next few days in four sessions, chapter 6, verses 10 to 20. And what we know is the Apostle Paul wrote to the Ephesian church, and in the first three chapters, he told them this transformation, this amazing thing occurred. You're brand new. You're accepted. You're redeemed. You have an eternal inheritance. You've been bought with a price. The Spirit has sealed you. There's this brand new thing in chapter 2. You were in the kingdom of darkness. You've been ransomed. Now you're in the kingdom of his beloved Son. There's this new entity called the church. And it's been a mystery, but it's been the mind and the heart of God since eternity past. Jew, Gentile, one new thing, new relationship. And then chapter 4 opens up and says, with this supernatural new life that you have with God the Father, through your relationship with Christ, by the Holy Spirit dwelling in you, walk in a manner worthy of your calling. And chapter 4 will talk about walking in purity, walking in light. Then chapter 5 will say, what's it look like to walk in the light and walk in purity and to walk in love? And it talks about relationships with husband and wife. And then chapter 6 will open up and talk about with children and then slaves. And so he's given us the entire orb or sphere of living the Christian life. This is what happened. This is who you are. This is how to do it. This is what it looks like. And then in chapter 6, beginning at verse 10, he says, by the way, don't forget this. This new life will be lived out in a hostile environment. You live in a fallen world. You are brand new, but you still have the flesh, and the flesh wages war against the spirit, right? Galatians. But not only that, is it a fallen world, a sinful world, things aren't the way God created them. He will make it all right one day, but it's a fallen world. You have this battle going on between the spirit and the flesh, and there is a supernatural angelic being who fell from heaven, who took a third of the angels with him, and his job and his goal and his strategy is to destroy your life, to murder you spiritually, emotionally, relationally, physically. He wants to take you out. He wants to ruin your life. He wants to ruin your marriage. He wants to ruin your children. He wants to split your church. He wants to have you overwhelmed, deceived, believing lies, and be rendered completely ineffective in this new relationship with Christ. so that the church and the gospel are discredited and you become a miserable person and all the work of God and the work of the cross and the resurrection goes for naught. And what he's going to say is, you better get your chin strap and you better buckle it, because this new life that you're living is in a very difficult spiritual environment. You are involved in, you can be aware of it or you cannot be aware of it, but you're in an invisible war. So open your Bibles to Ephesians chapter 6, 10 to 20, and let's start with spiritual warfare 101. This is the central teaching of the entire New Testament on spiritual warfare. So let's cover verses 10 to 12, and then I want to develop five basic truths. I mean the most elementary basic truths about spiritual warfare out of Ephesians 6, 10 to 12. The Apostle Paul says, finally, be strong in the Lord and in the strength of his might. Put on the full armor of God. Why? That you may be able to stand firm against the schemes of the devil. This reason, for the struggle, our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the powers, against the world forces of this darkness, against the spiritual forces of wickedness in the heavenly places. Now, in the margin, you might write two commands. In verses 10, 11, and 12, there are two commands. The first command is in verse 10. And this command is, be strong in the Lord. And then it tells you how, and in the strength of his might. Whatever we know about this battle, it's not about you mustering up certain strength or doing something on your own. There is strength available, there's power available, and the only way to win this war is be strong in the Lord, in what you already possess that he's told you about in Ephesians chapter 1, 2, and 3. Now, for those of you that kind of like a little bit of the grammar, this is in the present imperative, that means it's a command, and it's in what's called grammatically the passive voice. And that doesn't mean a lot to you, so notice in the notes it says verse 10, general command. The passive voice means it's, you can't do it, but you have to allow God to do something, yet it's a command to obey. So are you ready? This is the Chip Ingram paraphrase. Allow yourself to be continually strengthened by the power already available to you in your new position and relationship with Christ. And then alluding to what power? The power that raised Christ from the dead and now dwells in you. So there's a command. You need to allow God to work in your life in such a way that the power that has been made available in your new relationship with him gives you the strength to win this battle. You're going to find that you've already won the war. Now notice the second command is how to do it. Well, how do you do that? It says, put on the full armor of God, with the purpose is the idea that you can stand firm, or literally it's hold your ground. You're already in a conflict, but you're to put on the armor of God. That's God's provision so you can actively win this battle because you've already won the war. And so he says how to do this. You put on the full armor of God. That's verse 11. It's by continually and repeatedly putting on at specific points in time the spiritual protection God has provided for you. This verb is a little bit different one. It's in a tense that means at a punctiliar, at a point in time. The other one was a command, but this one says it has the idea of a sense of urgency. At specific times, you need to be ready and urgent and ready. Put on the armor of God. And this is what's called the middle voice. It's something that you cooperate and you do for yourself. You do it for the express purpose of holding on to your position in Christ as you're bombarded by satanic strategies designed to destroy you and or render you ineffective in your kingdom pursuits. So he's saying, be strong in the Lord. That's the way you win. How do you do it? By putting on the full armor of God. Where is the battle? There are, did you notice the little word schemes? Circle that word. We get our English word strategies. There is an invisible angelic being who has a host of demons that has specific strategies to take you out, to tempt you, to deceive you, to get you to believe lies, to get you to be drawn away from God, to get your heart filled with partial truths and untruths, to get you to try and go after a good thing in the wrong way or the wrong time or with the wrong person. He's got schemes. Now, notice, why do we need to do this? The reason is verse 12. He says, for our struggle. And you might circle that word. This word struggle means hand-to-hand combat. It was used in ancient Greek times of two people going into a wrestling match or hand-to-hand combat until one person was in victory and could hold the other person down. For our struggle, our battle, our hand-to-hand combat is not, notice, it's not with circumstances, it's not with people, it's not with another person, it's not with an organization. You get the idea? It is not with flesh and blood. The struggle or the conflict isn't a material issue. But it's an invisible war. And then what he begins to list for you is a very clear hierarchy of demonic power. Just like there are generals and lieutenants and majors and sergeants, he says it's not flesh and blood that your battle's against, but against the powers, against world forces of this darkness, against spiritual forces of wickedness. He makes it very clear it's because this real struggle or wrestling match isn't against physical, material adversaries, but against a hierarchy of demonic forces doing battle in the spiritual realm. Now, Paul basically is, you know what, when his readers were reading this, unlike being in the 21st century, they weren't going, ooh, wow, that sounds kind of weird. Demonic activity was very common in that day. They understood all about it. And he was just telling them some things that were realities in their life. Because like us, what happens? We get thinking the problem is our mate. We get thinking the problem is our boss. We get thinking the problem is one of our kids. We get thinking it's circumstances and situations. And we don't understand behind those things, there's an arch enemy that wants to use those to destroy our life. Now, we all make choices, and sometimes the consequences are bad things happen to us. We don't blame that on demonic forces or the enemy. Sometimes it's just a fallen world and circumstances happen. Everything, again, is not because of demonic forces. The danger as we approach this is to think that everything has to do with Satan and demons, or that nothing has to do with Satan and demons. As C.S. Lewis, I think, aptly said, when speaking about the reality of Satan and demonic activity, the danger is always twofold, to put way too much emphasis or way too little. And so with that, here's what I'd like to do. This is 101. I want to give you five basic truths that just flow right out of this passage and that you can know for sure this is true about spiritual warfare. So turn the page on your notes and we'll dig in together. Five basic truths about spiritual warfare. Truth number one, there is an invisible world that is just as real as the visible world. Now we are, empiricalism and scientific method. We've got now a couple, three, four centuries since the Enlightenment that we want to explain everything and test everything and measure everything. What I want you to know, there is a world. There's a world that you can't see. It's invisible. But it's as real as touching your skin. It's as real as when you kiss one of your children on the cheek and put them to bed. It's as real as when someone back ends into you and you find yourself with lower back pain and back spasms. It is as real as tasting and touching and watching a sunset. You know what? And we've got multiple examples. For centuries, people couldn't see bacteria, but was bacteria real? Viruses, are they real? Electricity, I can't see it, but it's doing some things, isn't it? Natural gas, I can't see it, but you know what? I've got a little thing in my house that if I light this and turn a little switch over here, whew. Carbon monoxide, I can't see it, I can't smell it. It is completely invisible, but if you stay in a room with enough of it, what will it do? It'll kill you. There's an invisible world. Let me give you an Old Testament example and a New Testament example. Turn in your Bibles, if you would, to 2 Kings 6. And as you turn there, I'm going to look at verse 15. And this is the story of one of the great prophets, Elisha. And as you turn there, I'll give you a little background. Elisha is making this king absolutely crazy. And he's doing a number of amazing things. He's God's man, and tremendous things are happening. And so they are trying to get rid of him. But every time they try to get rid of him, he sneaks out of it, or he knows it's coming. And finally, he gets fed up and says, you know what? I'm going to put an end to this thing. He gets a whole army together. He gets word where he is. He has an army and horsemen and chariots, and he surrounds the city. And he's going to get this prophet once and for all. And the prophet has a servant who works with him. And, you know, I don't know if he kind of got up and got his clothes ready or cooked a little breakfast or went out and got water. But, you know, the guy kind of gets up early and, you know, they're good buddies. And, loose translation here.
Hey, boss. Yeah, we got problems. Yeah, what? Come out here. You got to see this.
And the guy goes, We're dead. What are we going to do? I mean, it's surrounded troops and cavalry and chariots. I mean, there's no way. And this is a very interesting text in the Old Testament where God wants us to understand there are invisible realities that we do not see, but they are very, very real. Into that situation, verse 15, now when the attendant of the man of God had risen early and gone out, behold, an army with horses and chariots was circling the city. And his servant said to him, alas, my master, what shall we do? So he answered, do not fear, for those who are with us are more than those with them. And I'm thinking, if I'm that servant, I'm thinking, this guy's a prophet, God speak through him, he's powerful, but he's terrible in math. You know, I'm going, Hey, bro, come on out here. Let's count again. You, me, that's two. Now let's count all those. And then notice what he does. Look at verse 17. Then Elisha prayed and said, oh, Lord, I pray, open his eyes that he may see. And the Lord opened the servant's eyes, and he saw, and behold, the mountain was full of horses and chariots of fire all around Elisha. The Old Testament clearly documents that there is an invisible world that is real. He prayed and he had the power for that moment of time to see angelic beings and the protection that he had. In the New Testament, we have 2 Corinthians 10, 3-5. We'll look at it more later, but the only point I want to make is the Apostle Paul will say, the weapons of our warfare are not of the flesh. Though we live according to the flesh, we don't battle according to the flesh. He's going to say there's an invisible world, and he's going to introduce the idea that not only that, but there's an invisible war. In fact, not in your notes, but you want to jot down a very interesting passage, Daniel chapter 10, because there is a connection between this invisible world and this visible world. It's an old, old booklet that had a great impact on me by Francis Schaeffer, a little booklet called Two Contents, Two Realities. Francis Schaeffer just makes the point. There are two contents. There is a content of a material world, and there is a content of a spiritual world. There is a visible world and an invisible world. And there is a content of men and flesh and organizations and trees and sky and tangible things, and just as parallel, a real, invisible, non-material world. And there are realities occurring in this invisible world, and there are realities that we experience in this visible world. And then Schaeffer made the point, there is an arch or a connection between the invisible and the visible. And if you would read Daniel 10 very carefully, you find that he gets revelation that he doesn't understand. So he fasts and prays, and he gets no answer for the first 21 days. And after 21 days, I mean, one of the big heavy duty, like supercharged angels comes, not just a regular angel. And he says, Daniel, your prayer was heard on high and answered from the first day, but I was dispatched and I've been doing battle with the king of Persia. Now, we don't understand exactly, not a lot of details, and people make a lot of it. Here's what we know for sure. An angel was doing battle somewhere, and God was answering his prayer, and something happened in this invisible reality that had an impact on the visible reality. When a man prays, God is answering, and there's not only an invisible world, but fact number two, basic truth number two, we are involved in an invisible war. We're involved in a cosmic conflict that has eternal implications. Notice what the Apostle Paul says in 2 Corinthians 10, 3-5. For though we walk in the flesh, we don't war. Notice that word, war. That's a battle term, according to the flesh. Why? For the weapons of our warfare are not of the flesh, but divinely powerful for the destruction of fortresses. And then he begins to tell us where this war occurs. We are destroying speculations and everything raised up against the knowledge of God, and we are taking every thought captive to the obedience of Christ. Put a line under every thought captive. The battleground for this invisible war, this cosmic conflict, is largely between your ears. The attack is on your mind. He is the father of lies. He is a deceiver. He is a deluder. He cast doubt on God. He cast doubt on his word. He cast doubt on you. He wants you to believe a set of lies. And when you do spiritual warfare, he says, we pull down destructive, lofty things against the knowledge of God, and we take every thought captive to the obedience of Christ. Your mind, your belief system, your worldview, that's where the great majority of the battle occurs. And if you think this is just a small-time deal, look at 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 4. It's speaking here of in whose case the god of this world, Satan, has blinded the minds. Underline that word. The minds of unbelievers. Why? That they might not see the light of the gospel of the glory of Christ, who is the image of God. The battle is for the minds. You know, I had a situation. I just spoke at an Easter service at a church in Atlanta. And Teresa and myself have had a great relationship. I've been the interim teaching pastor for a year, and it was my second to the last service. And last week was the last service, and we had a little farewell, and it was a great time. And I did a little bit of an unusual Easter service in that I gave sort of a little brief overview, and then I gave, the core of what occurred on the cross in terms of reconciliation and redemption. I mean, it was the gospel. I mean, flat out. And I get together with a group of men before, I preach, and the one fellow was telling how his dad had come. His dad's an unbeliever. He's probably a guy about my age, maybe 5 or 6 years younger. And he said to me, I don't get it. I've been sharing Christ with my father for over 20 years. He came last week. He came to church. He said, that's the clearest, most persuasive hearing of the gospel I've ever heard in my life. And I went out to lunch with my dad afterwards, and I said, well, Dad, what did you think? And let's talk about it. And his response was, you know, I don't just really understand where Cain got his wife, do you? You know, if the Bible says this about Adam and Eve, and if Cain's over here, and he said, Chip, all I can tell you is, it was like BBs off of a tank. See, we tend to think that the knowledge of God is an intellectual issue. It is not.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.